In the last episode, you learned about SQL Server running in containers. In this episode, we'll take it to the next level with Kubernetes. This week on Data Exposed, MVP Edition. Hi, I'm Anna Hoffman, and welcome to this episode of Data Exposed, MVP Edition. Today, I'm joined once again by Anthony Nocentino. Thanks for joining us again, Anthony.
Thanks for having me back.
Always a pleasure. And today, we're going to talk about Kubernetes. Now, in the last episode, which we'll put a link to in the description, Anthony told us all about containers, how easy they are to get set up, and how fast they can be. Now, we're going to take it to the next level by talking about Kubernetes. So, we've been hearing this term a lot. Can you tell us, what the heck is going on with Kubernetes?
In our last session, we talked about what a container is. And the last thing that we're going to do in our data center is run around to a bunch of servers and type Docker run. And so what Kubernetes does for us is it's what's called a container orchestrator. It's the thing that's going to help us manage our containers in an enterprise way. And what we're going to do when we deploy containers inside of Kubernetes, we're going to wrap them in this abstraction that is a pod. And so what a pod is the running container, but also any resources that container needs to run. So in that last demonstration, when we talked about containers, you saw how I attached storage. Well, that's one of the elements of a pod. It's going to be the container itself, and also maybe the storage or other configuration elements wrapped up in a deployable unit. When we deploy applications in Kubernetes, we're going to deploy them as pods in a cluster. And what a cluster really is a collection of resources in a data center. So you can think of it as an aggregation of the servers or the CPU, disk, and RAM in our data center that we can deploy our applications onto. And that really gets us to one of the key constructs behind Kubernetes is this idea of infrastructure abstraction. We're going to care a little bit less about where our application runs in our data center, but we're going to aggregate those resources together and just consume those resources in code. And so when we talk about infrastructure abstraction and being able to write code to deploy our applications, specifically in Kubernetes, we're going to use this declarative configuration model. And so when we saw how I used Docker run in the previous Data Exposed episode, well, we're going to write code in YAML to deploy SQL Server or any application inside of Kubernetes. And we're going to see that in our upcoming demonstration. Now, one of the core constructs behind Kubernetes is this idea of desired state. And so that code that I write that says, hey, start up this SQL Server, Kubernetes is going to make sure that we stay in that state at all times. So if a SQL Server crashes, Kubernetes will figure that out and, it'll just start up another SQL Server. And that's a fantastic piece of functionality that we're going to get out of our cluster. And that's not just for SQL Server, but for any application that we deploy inside of Kubernetes.
Awesome. Thanks. And, so we got the Kubernetes 101. Now, how does this apply to the SQL world?
So here we are in Azure Data Studio, and I have a notebook to kind of walk us through the deployment and also the high availability options that we have of deploying SQL Server inside of Kubernetes. So I'm going to go ahead and kick off this deployment here, which is going to download the declarative code to deploy SQL Server in my cluster. And let's take a quick peek at what that looks like. And I don't want to get caught up in the details of the code here, but know that what we're doing in this code is we're deploying some storage. We're going to create and deploy a SQL Server and also put that SQL Server behind a load balancer inside of Azure. And with that code there, I'm able to deploy a SQL Server declaratively inside of my Kubernetes cluster. And so let's go ahead and see how we can connect to that. And so on line 6 here, I'm just going to run a command to get the version of SQL Server. So we see select add at version, run that code there. So running that code there, you can see we get the output at the bottom that we've deployed SQL Server 2019 CU4. We described it in code in that YAML manifest to deploy that inside of our Kubernetes cluster. Now, one of the key aspects behind that is I have code that describes that deployment. I can take that code, park that in source control, and manage that configuration over time. So I can make modifications to that and track those changes in my cluster when I have software-defined code for my deployments of SQL Server. Now, what I do want to show you is this, is inside of our cluster, if something goes wrong inside of SQL Server, Kubernetes will figure that out and recover. And so what we have here is shutdown with no wait, which is a command that's going to crash SQL Server. Kubernetes will see that SQL Server is no longer running, and just a few seconds later, we'll start that SQL Server up for me automatically. And so here we can see in the output at the bottom, it's already recovered and brought SQL Server back online.
Awesome. So in the previous video, you showed us how fast we can get SQL Server 2019 up and running in a container. And now you're showing us with Kubernetes how fast we can kill SQL Server and it just comes back up and it's running again. So very cool stuff.
So yeah, in addition to high availability, we also have the ability to build more complex systems in code. And we touched on that when we talked about containers, that containers are going to be the building blocks to those systems. And one of those systems we have on the screen here, which is a big data cluster. Now, I don't want to get caught up in the details of what a big data cluster is, but if you look at the bottom of the picture here, we can see that the underlying infrastructure supporting this complex system that is a big data cluster is Kubernetes. And what that enables Microsoft to do is to build these larger solutions in a software-defined way so that you can deploy those wherever you have Kubernetes. It's not being dependent on your physical infrastructure. Microsoft defines what a big data cluster looks like in code, and you're able to deploy that complex system just like I did in the demonstration today. Moving forward into the next generation of systems that we're seeing come from Microsoft is Azure Arc Data Services. Again, not focusing on what's going on inside of Azure Arc Data Services, but if you look at step one here, it says have Kubernetes in your infrastructure. And again, being able to extend those Azure services into your on-premises or multi-cloud scenarios in a very easily software-defined way.
Awesome. Thanks, Anthony. This has been really interesting to see how, you know, we've taken SQL Server really, and then we put it in containers and we put it in Kubernetes, and now it's opened all these doors up for us. And it's really just the, you know, the foundation or the underlying infrastructure that's going to support things like big data clusters and Azure Arc. So it's definitely something really excited. And I think probably a lot of people are looking forward to seeing more of in the future.
Yeah, on a personal note for me, when I saw these products and come out, that's when I really started paying attention to Kubernetes and being able to build these more complex systems to solve more complex problems and build solutions.
Awesome. Well, thanks so much for being on the show, Anthony. We'll put some links to where to learn more, where to see this notebook in the description, and we hope to see you next time on Data Exposed.